Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome back to Administrative Static. Mark Chenoweth here with John Vecchione, as always. And we had a cert petition filed this past week that I wanted to tell the audience about. This is, as John was just mentioning in the last segment, Chevron deference, these judicial deference doctrines are something that's very much in the wheelhouse of the new Civil Liberties Alliance. One of the reasons that we were formed One of the reasons that we gave for why people should help us set this organization up and keep us afloat is to overturn Chevron deference. And so John talked about a different case that's pending in front of the Supreme Court. We have just filed a cert petition in another case at the Supreme Court that that will have the opportunity to overturn Chevron deference as well. And this case involves a U.S. Air Force veteran named Thomas Buffington. And the particular problem that he has is that the VA it does not want to give him all of the disability benefits which are due to him. So he had served honorably, was honorably discharged a couple decades ago or over a decade ago. And he... There's no disagreement.
With disability. He'd had, Mark, the key thing is he'd had a disability and then they needed him back for something and he went back.
That's right. That's right. And his disability is tinnitus. It's a hearing issue and it was a 10% disability. And he accepts that that's the percentage and the military accepts that that's the percentage. There's no dispute over that. But he was called back to active duty. He served for some additional time and then he was honorably discharged again. And sometime after that, a couple, three years after that, he went back to the VA and said, hey, you know, you under federal law, my disability benefits were stopped at the time that I went back into active duty, because that's what the federal law says is you can't get both your disability payments and your active duty pay at the same time. So that was fine. But then once he went off of active duty, his disability benefits didn't resume. And he said, look, I'd like for those disability benefits to resume. And the Veterans Administration said, or Department of Veteran Affairs said, no, you can, we can't go all the way back to the date when your active duty ceased. We can only go back 1 year. And the statute doesn't say that, but a regulation that the Department of Veteran Affairs promulgated created that 1 year look back provision and sort of a restriction on disability benefits. Well, so there's a couple problems with that. And he, Mr. Buffington had taken this issue all the way up to the federal circuit, which is one of the non-geographical circuits in the United States, but it's the one that handles appeals from the veterans benefits process. And the federal circuit upheld the VA's interpretation of the statute. And it's essentially said, look, this could go either way. We understand that there's this canon of statutory interpretation called the veteran canon or the, you know, the pro-veteran canon. But there's also this other idea called Chevron deference. And we're going to apply Chevron deference, not the veteran canon. And Chevron deference says that we will defer to the agency's reasonable interpretation of the statute in case of an ambiguity. We think the statute's ambiguous here, or rather, it wasn't so much that they said there was ambiguity and that the language was ambiguous, but they said there was a gap in the statute. The statute didn't speak to this particular issue. And so they were going to defer to the VA's interpretation of the statute. There was a dissent, and now we have taken the case. It was not our case at the federal circuit, but we are now representing Mr. Buffington in seeking a cert petition at the U.S. Supreme Court. And the petition raises two questions. The first question is whether or not Chevron deference can be applied when the veteran canon has not been applied yet. Because the way that we look at Chevron at NCLA, even under current law, the way we look at Chevron is that if there's an ambiguity, unless there's an ambiguity, you don't get to step two. Step two of Chevron is the step at which deference to an administrative agency's reasonable interpretation might take place. But step one is the step where the Supreme Court has said, originally in Chevron, most recently in Kaiser and elsewhere, look, you have to use all of the tools in your statutory toolkit before you decide that a statute is ambiguous. And one of the tools in the statutory toolkit is the pro-veteran canon of statutory interpretation. And what that canon says is that in the case of an ambiguity about an issue that's a statutory issue applicable to veterans, that you would interpret the statute in a way that is favorable to the veteran. Congress legislates against that background assumption. The pro-veteran canon has been around for a long time, at least since World War II. And Congress has passed these various veterans benefits statutes knowing that that canon exists. So the idea that that the Federal Circuit or any other federal court would not apply the pro-veteran canon as one of the tools in its statutory toolkit is a problem. And so what we've done is asked the Supreme Court to tell the Federal Circuit and all federal courts, look, the pro-veteran canon is in the statutory toolkit. It is a step one of the Chevron process tool. You have to use it. And by the way, if you use it here, there will no longer be ambiguity in the statute. The canon of construction will have resolved that issue. And then you never get to step two of Chevron. So it could be that the Supreme Court will decide that if it takes this case, and that's always a big if, but if it takes this case, it could decide it on that ground. But the second question that we have presented to the court is the possibility of overturning Chevron entirely. And we have explained to the Supreme Court that look, Chevron has a host of problems. It was wrongly decided, and that stare decisis doesn't really support retaining Chevron, because the sort of fiction behind Chevron is that there's legislative intent to have these sort of statutory gaps filled by the administrative agency. But that runs counter to the assumption that's in the pro-veteran canon. The pro-veteran canon assumes that Congress wants the benefits to go to the veterans. But if you listen to the VA's interpretation, which is often an anti-veteran interpretation, then you're not going to get to the same place that Congress would arrive at. So the idea that you have to employ Chevron because of reasons of stare decisis doesn't really hold. And we point out a lot of different factors here, including that because Chevron is a sort of statutory interpretation method, it's not clear that it should get stare decisis treatment anyway. It's not like a substantive precedent about a holding of law about a particular statutory provision or constitutional provision. So it's not clear that stare decisis would even come in at all. But even if you would give stare decisis treatment, it's not clear that's consistent with what is called for in these sorts of veterans cases. And of course, we've made the usual arguments that NCLA makes and that Professor Hamburger, our founder, Philip Hamburger, is famous for making about Chevron and the problems with Chevron. And that is twofold. One, that it violates due process when an independent federal judge, ostensibly independent federal judge, defers to the statutory interpretation of one of the two parties who's in front of that judge. If you defer to the Department of Veterans Affairs and its interpretation, then Mr. Buffington isn't getting a fair hearing from an independent judge. He's getting a court that's deferring to the other party that he's suing. Well, that's not really due process of law. And so that's a problem with the entire Chevron framework, and a reason why that entire framework ought to be built, ought to be torn down. The second problem that we talk about is that this does interfere with the independence of the judiciary. It's the judge's job to say what the statute means. It's not the job of the executive branch, whether that's the Department of Veterans Affairs or anyone else in the executive branch. It's not their job to say what the statutes mean. And so if you defer to the executive branch, you're essentially giving up the judicial power that the Constitution put in the Article III courts, and you're transferring that over to the executive branch where it doesn't belong. And so that's a kind of separation of powers problem. It's a violation of the independence of the judiciary problem, and something that we don't get into as much in this petition for cert, but that we talk about elsewhere, is that the Constitution went to great lengths, extensive lengths, to ensure the independence of the judiciary. And it's just inconsistent with that independence. And that, you know what these things are, right? It's life tenure. It's the fact that you can't reduce the pay of members of the judiciary. It's the fact that members of the judiciary cannot simultaneously serve in either of the other two branches. There's all these factors that go into the independence of the judiciary in order to make sure that they are empowered and equipped to decide these cases independently, fairly, and in accordance with due process of law. And Chevron deference undermines that entire regime. It takes it, it just with one fell swoop, Chevron undercuts the independence of the judiciary. So we asked the court to reconsider Chevron. And John, you're sort of consistent with what you were talking about earlier. Maybe this will be one of these cases that the court will be brave enough to take now. The fact that it took the other Chevron case earlier this term is a good sign. And this is actually, particularly if it decides it on the veteran canon issue, this is maybe a less extreme case than the one it's already taken.
That's true. It they have the option of whittling it down. You know, and Kaiser, what they've been saying lately is, well, Chevron and all these deference, they still exist, but you got to do all these things before you use them. And they've been making it more like, I don't know if you ever saw The Man with Two Brains, but he gets pulled over by the Austrian police and they have more and more things he's got to do to show that he's sober. And they have him like jumping rope backwards and standing on his hands and all these things. And I think the court would go in that direction, that you have to go through every single one of the interpretive methods before you get there. Now, then they'll take a case later that they knock it down. So.
Well, and for this case, I would settle for them saying, look, you have to apply the pro-veteran canon of construction. We'll be back with more right after this. Welcome back to Administrative Static. We have another case to talk about in the U.S. Supreme Court this week, and that is Apartment Association of Los Angeles County versus City of Los Angeles. And this is case number 21-788 at the Supreme Court. And the New Civil Liberties Alliance filed an amicus brief in that case this week. Our colleague Jared McLean was the counsel of record on that case. And the issue there has to do with this issue that John knows a whole lot about, which is these lockdowns that have been taking place around the country and preventing people from preventing landlords from kicking tenants out of housing. And Los Angeles, even though the federal one has gone away, Los Angeles County still has a version of this in place. And the Apartment Association is sued on, among other theories as to why it should prevail, the Contracts Clause of the United States Constitution. And what the Contracts Clause specifies is that states cannot pass laws that are in conflict with pre-existing contracts. So it's a protection that's been in there since day one. And the original understanding of the Contracts Clause, you know, from 1787 was based in some of the conduct that the colonies were engaged in or states were engaged in the 1780s, that they were, you know, there are often more parties with debt than there are parties that are holding debt, right? That's just like there are many more tenants than there are landlords. And so it's a popular position often for politicians to take the side of the more populous group, because they, you know, the landlord has one vote and the tenants have, you know, however many 10, 100,000 votes, whatever it is. And so you can understand why the person who counts on getting more votes would want to side with the more numerous population. But the Contracts Clause recognized, and the United States Constitution recognized, that protection for property rights is very important for the stability of the economy, for the stability of contractual relations. Folks aren't going to enter into contracts if they think the state can come along and vitiate those contracts at any point in time.
For supply of the housing market.
Absolutely. For supply of the housing market, for the cost of the housing market, for the affordability, for the size of the security deposits that are going to be required in order to be able to move into these housing units. There's all sorts of things that having secure contracts rights keeps these things affordable and in check and ensures that there isn't violence as well, right? I mean, historically, there was a lot of violence when landlords would kick tenants out of housing units. They would do it at the point of at the barrel of a gun, and we've gotten past that. And the states have by and large entrusted it to the sheriffs to do these things, and the legal process has to take place first. And oftentimes, it's the threat of the legal process that encourages a tenant to reach some sort of reasonable compromise. But if the state jumps in and says, yeah, you know what, you're not bound by the terms of that contract anymore, or you're not bound by it for a year or two, then all of the incentive on the part of the tenant to engage in good faith negotiation goes out the window. But the question here, and this gets back to something John was talking about earlier in the episode, gets back to whether or not the Supreme Court is going to want to venture into the contracts clause, whether or not whether this is another one of those sort of long neglected ideas that the court might want to reinvigorate. And in the statutory area, we talk about desuetude, that does a statute still have, it's a fancy word, but just means, does a statute still have validity if it hasn't been enforced for decades, or does it sort of fall by the wayside, even though it might be on the books? Well, there's a similar sort of idea in constitutional law. If the contracts clause just isn't going to be enforced for years on end or decades on end, does that mean that it doesn't have any force anymore? Or is the conduct of the County of Los Angeles so egregious in this instance that the Supreme Court might, or the City of Los Angeles, that the Supreme Court might be willing to take a look at that conduct and say, look, this violates the contracts clause. So whatever we said about it back in the 1930s, when we set out some limiting principles in Blaisdell, then you know it might still be the case that there are ways that a state law can impair contractual obligations. And in this case, the state law goes too far, or the city ordinance goes too far. The courts have to go ahead.
I also think that they have to have a basis. They could even just raise the level in order to do impair contract, in order to affect contracts. Well, they have to have a real good reason. And here, one of the things that cheeses me off about all this is that they always say it's to stop the spread of COVID. And there is zero evidence that stopping eviction stops the spread of COVID. There's less than zero. In fact, And there's no eviction crisis. After the federal eviction moratorium went away, nothing changed. Zero.
Wait a minute. I thought there was going to be an eviction crisis, John. If you won your case,
this huge spread, but it ended long before Omicron, before anything. Nothing happened. There's no basis at all. It's just the government saying it. They go to court and they say, this will happen. This is why we're doing it. And this goes back to the court's deference. Oh, well, the government says that. Who am I to say? It's ridiculous. Not one. And the media, this is, I rarely go against, attack the media on this program. But one of the things that really bothers me is that there hasn't been one article in any publication that I've seen, left, right, indifferent, going back and saying, hey, what happened? Where's the parade of horribles we were all promised when the government put in this huge regulation? Not one article.
The eviction crisis that wasn't would be the title of that article. Yeah, because look, landlords don't want to evict people either. That's not what they're not in the business to evict people. They're in the business of trying to keep people in the housing. That's the only way they make money, is if they have tenants and they're willing to reach reasonable accommodations with folks. But if the incentive for good faith negotiation has been completely taken away from the tenant side of that negotiation, then we heard reports, and John, you can chime in on this because you were the ones directly talking to the clients in a lot of these cases. We heard reports of landlords saying, yeah, this guy hasn't paid me in a year, but he's got a second house out on the beach now that he didn't have before. He's got a brand new car in the driveway.
Yeah, or he's posting on Facebook his trips to the Dominican Republic or Costa Rica or something when he's off scuba diving. It's absolutely outrageous.
So, you know, and neither John nor I is trying to say that this is true of every single tenant out there who wasn't making rent. That's not the point. The point is that by changing up the incentive structure the way that the government policy did, it enabled some people to take advantage of the situation, and many of them did in a fraudulent sort of way. And I haven't seen any effort on the part of the city of Los Angeles or the United States government to crack down one bit on folks who didn't pay their rent when they could have, and who spent that rent on things like trips to the Caribbean or you know, purchasing new motorcycle or car or what have you. It's an unfortunate side effect. But be that as it may, the contracts clause is one of the ways that the federal government can keep states in check on this. This is part of the federal law. It's in the United States Constitution, and it tells the states that they can't go down this road of interfering with contractual relationships. And this provision of the Constitution was enforced faithfully for 150 years, you know, from the founding right up until 1937. It was faithfully applied, and that was through many kinds of financial crises where the Supreme Court understood that security of, you know, whatever else is wrong in a financial situation, undermining the security of contracts is not going to make that financial situation better. It's not going to make the recovery faster if you start undermining the security of contracts.
And that's another thing that they always said, the contract has to be enforced. You can't interfere with it. But if you want to make a new law about things that are ultra virus, things you can't do in a contract, you can do that, but it should affect future contracts, not the existing contracts. And that's right. Really what's going on here. This is not trying to take away state powers to govern their contract law. It's to take away their ability to interfere with an existing contract.
That's right. And if it were prospective, then the legislature would be involved, and the legislature would hear from both sides. It could weigh it, and both sides of the contract could decide whether they want to enter into the new contract based on the new background rules and laws and so forth, right? And you might say, okay, well, I will enter into that contract, but now I'm going to ask for a bigger security deposit or what have you. But when you interfere with an existing contract, there's no ability for your counterparty to not enter into the contract. That ability has been taken away from you. So you can't modulate your ex ante conduct to account for the change in the law. And that's why it is a violation of the rule of law to have these sort of interference with contracts taking place by the city of Los Angeles or anyone else. And unfortunately, until the Supreme Court does act, lower courts have been treating, and they did in this case, have been treating the contracts clause as a dead letter. The Ninth Circuit here essentially said, yeah, contracts clause, schmontracts clause. There's not, you know, that's not really a reason that the city of Los Angeles has to worry about. And there is a split in the courts on how to assess substantial impairment. That could be one reason why the Supreme Court might take up this case for decision. The fact that you know, some states or circuits have eviscerated the contracts clause more than others is another reason why it might take it up. Or it might just look at it and say, look, it's okay for a state law in some circumstances. And look, this isn't what I'm advocating. I think the contracts clause should be sacrosanct. But courts must ensure that a state law is appropriately tailored to a significant and legitimate purpose. That could be another sort of way that the Supreme Court might come at this and say, look, you might be able to do this in some sort of true emergency. But as John says, we have very strong proof here that there isn't a good relationship between the eviction sort of moratorium reaction and keeping people from being evicted or having a housing problem, nor does this stop the spread of COVID. So the fact that we have that factual information could come into play as well. Thanks for being with us on Administrative Static. Until next week.